even non-classified information occasionally can have sensitive ramifications. In the case that I talked about in Mukasey State, the government was required, as it is in virtually all cases, we are indicted under the conspiracy statute, to notify the defendants who were the other members of the conspiracy, who were the unindicted co-conspirators, because indictments invariably lead in a stylized way. The others to the grand jury known and unknown. So the first question is, why? Who are the others? That list included Osama bin Laden, who was in 1995 relatively unknown. Within weeks, that list was in the hands of Osama bin Laden in Khartoum, without a Khartoum very soon after. That was not classified information. It was sensitive information that could not be controlled. It's been suggested that if a protective order were entered, it would control that kind of information. I entered a protective order in a case involving discovery information that consisted of transcripts that were played at trial. They were on the front page of the New York Times 2 days later. Protective order was good in civil cases where you have lawyers who believe they have something to do with in criminal cases where either you have defendants representing themselves, or defendants who have very little to do, or lawyers who subscribe to the agenda of their clients, a protective order affords very little protection at all. Wholly apart from the issue of protective orders, the requirement under CIPA is that all issues of classification, admissibility, summary, and so forth, be resolved before trial. So essentially, the government has to lay out any and all of the classified information proposed to introduce. All of that would have to be litigated. Those litigations involve appeals. All of that has to be done before trial, in essence, the government can find the case or that part of the case that consists of classified information twice. Once before, once during. And the appeal from counsel on their course. How long would such a proceeding take overall? As I mentioned, when the Mukaseys pleaded guilty, the indictment containing the charge in this case hasn't even been filed. These people have yet been indicted in New York, and once they get indicted, they will be pre-trial motions addressed to all the matter of things that are properly addressed in pre-trial motions, including motions to change venue on the ground that they can't get a fair trial in New York, motions to dismiss the indictment on the ground that they can't get a fair trial at all, since the Attorney General has already said that failure is not that acquittal, essentially it's not an option. And and the President said that Michelle deserves to be convicted next year. If I were the defense lawyer right there, possibly the first motion on my file would be a motion to arrest for those statements. Fully apart from the very technical demand of Fourth Amendment violations that will be filed and may very well have a good deal of merit, and as much as this case was not investigated to be tried in a federal court, when cases are investigated for trial in court, investigators follow protocols involving gathering evidence, involving giving Miranda warnings, and so on and so forth. That was not done in this case. A candidate for president, who is now president, said at one time that the notion of soldiers giving Miranda warnings was absurd. That's now done in Afghanistan because of this very state of mind that's taken over. Pre-trial proceedings that I mentioned, the secret proceedings, I think are likely to consume years. perfect, it will be appealed to the Supreme Court. After that, it's decided it will be habeas proceedings. That's a very long time. What does that mean? Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. His trial will be infinitely more complicated. Unlike the Seward case, where you have terrorism cases, tried as a in court. As I said, the case against him was not investigated in conventional ways, and all barriers relating to the gap of the evidence had to be overcome before it could be presented. Not to mention, of course, his right under the Constitution to act as his own lawyer. What that implicates, again, we have an example in the case of Zacharias Mousavi, the so-called 28 farm, attorney hijacker, who pleaded guilty in a federal court in Virginia. And the sentencing phase, the entire proceeding consumed 4 years. The sentencing phase of this trial took over a year. That was only the sentencing phase. I haven't gone into the issues of physical security of the distance of such a trial. From the judge, the jurors, the physical facilities that house the defendants and serve as the venues of trial. You can well imagine those, and we've seen those before. I've seen them personally before. And it's more simple, more to do with the physical security of those people and places who are immediately involved in the trial itself. I said a while ago that Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, or KSM, is finally known, would use the proceedings as a stage, as the occasion for a spectacle to serve the ideology that he stands for, and that tendency obviously is not unique to him, and it's not unique to Zacharias Mousavi, and indeed would be confined to a courtroom. The fact that he would be confined to a courtroom can be expressed in two words, I think, moonlight. Terrorists who shot, killed, and burned in Mumbai were interested in holding the stage and the world's attention. That was proved beyond any conceivable doubt in recent disclosure of playing the cell phone conversation that took place between those who were carrying out the exercise and those who were directing them, where one is told by the person directing him, you have the most important target. The media are showing pictures of the Taj, meaning the Taj Hotel in Mumbai, the center of the murder and the burning, and that was appealing. Persons carrying out that atrocity were told to focus there because that's what cameras were. An attack like that, or an attack on subways or walls, whether in New York or anywhere else in the United States, becomes that much more inviting an event if the trial itself is broken in the easy reach of the media. And where are these people to be confined, assuming that some punishment rather than death is being asked for any of them? We're assured by the Attorney General that special administrative measures, so-called SAMs, will apply to them so that they'll be kept in solitary confinement. What we're not told is that those special administrative measures were supposed to apply to a man named Richard Reed. I don't know whether you all remember Richard Reed, who was shot was a passenger on an airplane, tried to blow it up by lighting explosives that were concealed in his shoes. Would have succeeded, but for the fact that he spent the previous part of the day walking around London and it was wet that day. especially Sam, the special administrative procedure, was supposed to apply to him.